Here to talk more about the mobile stroke unit is Dr. Sean Savitz, professor of neurology at UT Health. Dr. Savitz, nice to see you.
Thank you.
This work is fascinating. I mentioned in the introduction the importance of time in treating a stroke. I am a mere amateur. You are a professional. So go deeper on this. Explain the relationship between time and treatment and how the mobile stroke unit we just saw and heard tell of would play such a big role in treatment.
Sure. So in a stroke, the most common cause of stroke is due to a blockage of an artery that feeds the brain.
Okay.
So under those circumstances where the artery is blocked, brain cells are starving for oxygen and for needed nutrients and sugar.
Right.
So every minute that goes by, unfortunately, the brain starts to lose more and more of those brain cells. The only approved treatment that we have that was actually approved in 1996 is a drug called tissue plasminogen activator, TPA, is its abbreviation.
Yep.
And what that drug does is it basically opens up the arteries. And what we have found over time and through the years and through many different studies is that the longer you go out after the onset of symptoms, the less of a chance that you're going to benefit from TPA.
Right.
So,
and the reverse is obviously true. The faster you get TPA into the system, the more likely you are to bring somebody toward recovery.
And not only that, but it's actually been shown very recently that if we could cut that time down, if we could shave off even a minute, shaving off a minute in time could translate to actually having one extra day of healthy life.
Wow.
That's what's been shown recently.
That's amazing. Now, the mobile stroke unit I mentioned is the only one in the nation, right? And this is true. And it's in Houston.
It is the only one in the nation.
The only one.
We have built it here at UT. And in Houston itself, it is going to be deployed, and it actually will start up actually in the next week.
So I want to understand. So next week, we're literally on the cusp of this.
Yes. Act.
So I want to understand exactly how this works. So let's say somebody calls 911. So what happens at that point?
So what will happen is that if a patient is experiencing symptoms of a stroke, or if they are basically, if the family member of a patient was to call 911, then that call will actually go to somebody that's part of our emergency medical services, and they have been given some guidance around whether they think that this patient could benefit from having a mobile stroke unit go out to the patient.
Right.
So what would happen is that our team will be activated, that this patient may be having a stroke, and we have a team that will be available at all times to basically go out in this ambulance and actually go out to the patient.
You can determine on the basis of the information you get on the front end whether this is a time to deploy the mobile stroke unit or not.
In fact, among the various different challenges that we've had in actually setting this whole mobile stroke unit up, we actually have been partnering with emergency medical services to talk about what are some of the things that they may hear on the telephone from the patient or the family.
That are kind of a tripwire, right?
That will trigger and say, we actually need to activate this mobile stroke unit right now.
I have to believe that, I know this was an idea that was long in coming, right? I have to believe there were challenges in figuring out how exactly to set this up and how to get it off the ground. Would you talk about that?
Absolutely. So, you know, as we said, you know, time is brain. Every minute that goes by that somebody could be in the midst of a stroke, that is somebody that must get to the hospital right away to get treatment. So for the past 15 years, Houston and many other centers have been the leaders in trying to get patients into the hospital as fast as possible.
Right.
And so the logistical issues around that have been that when a patient comes into the hospital, you don't know whether there's a blockage of an artery that's going on or whether the artery has ruptured and there's bleeding in the head.
Right.
So the key critical thing that you need to do is a CAT scan. A CAT scan is needed to basically make sure that there's no blood in the brain. And if you think somebody's having a stroke, then you could get TPA. So you know, my former chairman that is directing this particular mobile stroke unit has spent many years, decades actually, and being one of the leaders in the country to set up systems of care so that patients can be brought into the hospital as fast as possible. And that's what we were doing in the 90s and in the early 2000s. What we can do now is understanding that there's a lot of delay when a patient is actually calling 911 and is then taken to the hospital, and then within the hospital, you gotta get that CAT scan. That could be more than 60 minutes.
Right.
So with the mobile stroke unit is gonna be transformative because we're gonna bring the stroke doctor and the CAT scan to the patient. And so what we're talking about here is we could be shaving off maybe 60 minutes of time.
Yeah. So let me come back. I'm sort of stuck on this idea of the warning signs that would cause the stroke unit to be activated. So I want you to tell us what those are, actually.
Sure.
I want you to tell me what those are. Give us a short course on exactly what the warning signs are that might be, you know, okay, now we need to get this thing out there.
Okay, well, the most
Everybody take notes on this. This is actually... This is some serious education. So
the most common symptoms of a stroke are that if you suddenly could no longer move your arm or you could no longer move your leg,
right,
that would definitely be very concerning and should trigger a 911 call. Yeah. If you couldn't see out of an eye or you lost your vision suddenly, that's another symptom. If you couldn't, if you all of a sudden could no longer speak,
yeah,
or the words that are coming out of your mouth make no sense, or even if you're talking to somebody or and you're listening to them and what they're saying makes no sense,
right,
which is an interesting excuse for
that unfortunately happens to be a fair amount of the time. So
under those circumstances, any of those kind of symptoms, even a really, really severe sudden headache could be the symptoms of a stroke.
So all these are warning signs, that's right.
Yes, all of them are warning signs.
All right, so what is to prevent other institutions in Texas within this system, elsewhere in the medical field in Texas, or for that matter, outside of Texas, what's preventing them from having one of these? Won't they all want one? But beyond that, what are the obstacles to having more of these around Texas and elsewhere?
Oh, I think we're all going to want one.
Yeah.
I think it's what we have to prove is a number of different things. So first of all, we need to be able to know just how much faster are we going to treat the patient. That's a big question.
Yeah.
We're going to address that in our first pilot study.
Right.
That
we're so once you deploy, you're going to be able to prove the theory of the case here.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah. And so we project that we could save at least 30 to 60 minutes. And if you times that by the fact that we're losing 2 million brain cells per minute, that's a lot of brain cells that we're going to
save. And so if this, you sort of make this case that it works, then obviously people are going to go, we got to have more of these.
That's right. So if we can prove that it's feasible, that it's faster to treat them, that they get even better in terms of cutting down that time. And then the last question is this cost effective?
Yeah.
And if we can prove those three questions, we believe that then we could see multiple mobile stroke units basically being established across the country.
Fan out. Yeah. So I'm thinking about technology here, and I'm thinking about the idea of telemedicine, which is becoming more of a part of the conversation about medicine these days. I'm wondering if there's a way for telemedicine to play a role with the mobile stroke unit. Could you possibly do remote diagnoses or even remote treatments of some sort using this thing?
I think telemedicine has been one of the, I would say, the second revolution in stroke after TPA.
Yeah.
Because what we can do with telemedicine is use audiovisual equipment so that you can set up seeing the patient remotely. So if a patient is at a community hospital or is at a rural hospital, we can turn on a device, essentially a monitor, and we can actually see that patient through a web-based system, for example, and that's the audiovisual equipment.
And that's adequately reliable as a tool of diagnosis to do that?
Our center has shown that it's reliable
and
that we can increase the rate of TPA treatments because if the patient's at an outside facility, we can be the expert on that particular screen using that telemedicine. So we have shown using telemedicine by deploying it in many different community hospitals and rural hospitals, 15 that we've set up in the past 3 years, our TPA treatment rates, we treated 245 patients in just 1 year.
Is that right?
In the past year.
Yeah.
So with the mobile stroke unit, what we're looking at is something else with telemedicine, which is it possible if we put the device in the actual unit, could we actually then actually guide treatment for TPA, and we don't need a doctor to be, let's say, on the unit. Because right now, the way we're going to do this is, and our team is actually going to include a stroke physician. A stroke physician is going to go to the patient's home.
Right.
But we could use telemedicine, perhaps, in the future, and we're going to test that in our study rather than using the doctor.
I think that's incredibly interesting. That's just so great. So you've done work like this at UT Health for a long time on strokes, not just the mobile health unit, but there have been a bunch of other firsts that you all have accomplished there. And I'm thinking particularly about stem cell, and I'm thinking also about the use of off-label meds. So could you talk just briefly about stem cell therapies and off-label meds as two other things you've worked on as it relates to stroke treatment?
Absolutely. So for several years, we have been leading developments and trying to find innovative therapies for really a range of different conditions with regards to stroke and neurological disorders. And the reason is because TPA is really important. It's our only approved treatment, but it doesn't work as well as we would like to. Only 1 in 3 are going to get better after TPA. So it is an urgent public health need to develop new therapies. Stem cells has been one of the areas that we have been working in very closely.
Right. Controversial, but
in the way that we've been actually testing these cells, we've been taking them from the patient. We've been testing these stem cells from the patient's bone marrow.
Yep.
Our bodies have lots of different stem cells inside of them. So these are adult-derived cells. We have received the first federal NIH funding to test a patient's own cells.
Yep.
And we have found some really amazing results in some of our patients. We have seen some dramatic improvements in some of those patients, and it's going to take us to the next level in terms of wanting to be able to fully understand how they work We've been using brain imaging to see, and we actually now can see, that some of those patients are undergoing extensive brain repair.
This ties back to Dr. Chapman's
conversation. It absolutely
does.
Resilience
of the brain, that's it.
Absolutely right. Yeah. And so that's.
I love it when it works out like that, isn't that great?
And yeah. Our next step is to be able to say, well, you know, we may be able to take stem cells from a different person, a healthy volunteer, take it from the bone marrow of a healthy volunteer, and use those cells to treat patients in a very large clinical trial to see if that's actually going to help them just as much as their own patient cells.
Well, that's it's incredibly cool stuff that you're doing. The mobile stroke unit does seem like a big deal. So you said 1 week, it's going to deploy in 1 week.
That's right. In 1 week, we are getting started.
And then you're going to have to come back and tell everybody what happens. That's okay. So good. Dr. Sean Savitz, thank you so much for being here. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Savitz, thank you. Enjoyed it.
Thank you very much.
That's great. All right.